I got, after high school, went to college, got my associate's in criminal justice, and then reserved for a very short time at Florence Police Department when I was hired on at the sheriff's office in 96. Did about 7.5 years there, and then went to the Canyon City Police Department for another 16 years. And then in 2019, I was asked to come back over to the sheriff's office as the undersheriff for the office. How many of you were even thinking about a law enforcement career? A few of you? Okay. I can tell you right now that within law enforcement, we've seen the pendulum swing over the last 25, 26 years. When I first started in 96, the FBI NIBRS data was suggesting that that was an extremely violent time, not only for criminals and victims, but law enforcement as well. Right now, we're seeing the pendulum swing back over to the left, to where law enforcement efforts are almost being hampered by legislatures. The last bill that they kicked out last year, 217, required us to operate differently, and maybe not so much that we look at that as a bad thing. I do think there were reforms that were needed within law enforcement, but a lot of the reforms that were kicked out under that bill are extremely costly. One thing that a lot of people do not think about when it comes to law enforcement is the cost of investigating crime. I figured it up on paper one time, and for us to respond to a suicide jumper off of the Royal George Bridge costs on average between $4,500 and $5,000. And that's in fuel, man hours, the whole gamut, up and including autopsy. So if you guys are thinking about law enforcement in your future, start thinking about it now, along with any other trade. But I can tell you it is extremely rewarding. It is also extremely difficult at times. But every now and then you do come across somebody that you can actually help and change their life. So.
Yep. Next.
My name is Travis Bain. I was born and raised in Canyon. I work for the water department right now. I started with the city water department in 2004. So I started in the distribution side of things. There's two divisions in the water department. Distribution is more construction-based division. So that's like laying the water mains and fixing water hydrants. There's ever a water leak. And there was an opportunity for me to go to the water treatment plants in 2006. So I did that because operations interested me a little bit more. And so I kind of moved into getting my certifications in water treatment, four levels of certification, DCBNA. So I got my A certification and then a lot of enough to be an operator. So I did that for 7 years and then moved into management for the last 7 years, I guess. And a couple weeks ago, moved into upper management, now water superintendent. So I kind of went all the way from digging the ditches all the way up to leading the water department. Yeah.
Thank you. And next.
Jeff Peterson of operations for the school district here. I started here in the district in 92. Started out in maintenance. So the reason I got started with maintenance is I like trying to fix things. I worked there for 8-9 years, something in maintenance. And then a position in the warehouse came open. I just kind of wanted to learn all about the district, everything about the district. So I went in there for a little while, went back to maintenance. Now the past 10 years I've been the director of operations for the district. This I was kind of like, started out digging the ditches and kind of moved my way up there. It's really helped me though, start at the bottom and moving up. It's pretty much everything that happens in the district now. Able to do whatever needs to be done, any kind of call we get here in the district, we should be able to take care of. It's really helped starting at the bottom and moving my way up. Thank you.
All right, thanks so much. What do you find most enjoyable about your job? What do you like the best? Any of you just jump in. I don't know if we can just keep going down the order, but however you want to do it.
Where I'm at now, or opposed to where I was then?
Where you were then. Let's start at the beginning.
I was kind of an adrenaline junkie in my younger days. When a hot call, like an assault or something, come over the radio, and it was time to go. Turn on the red and blues, and you're off. Back then, we were dealing with call to call to call all night long on swing shift. And we were actually talking about it a couple weeks ago. There was one Thursday night 20 years ago to where we didn't ever turn the overheads off. We got in the car at 6 p.m. and ran all night long for 10 solid hours and never had to turn anything off. But I think back then it was the action that we saw to some aspect, but it was rewarding at the end of the day because everybody went home and we took care of the victims and put their assailants in jail. I mean, that was a lot of fun back then. Now, not so much because I drive a desk. For me right now, the most rewarding thing is watching staff members succeed in their positions.
So when I started with the water department, like I said, I was in distribution. I really enjoyed the working with my hands aspect of that. So you go out on a water leak and get to play in the mud, and you know, you had a problem, you're able to fix it. In the treatment side of things, I really enjoy the problem solving aspects that we have. So whenever we have an issue there, it's more of a technical issue. So it's gathering data, it's kind of getting together with the group, trying to figure out the best path forward and then implement the plan. That was really enjoyable in operations. And now in management, it's nice to be able to mentor people and kind of have a vision of what you want to do and try to find that path forward to better the department.
I think for me it's pretty easy. It's something different every day. We do not run into the same problem. Even cooling wise, if you got a hot room, cold room, whatever, I mean, that's the same, but it's something different here every day. I mean, water leaks, like I said, heating and cooling, broken lines and irrigation. Shoot, this morning we had a skunk in the bus lane at the middle school. I was excited. Got deer wrapped up in the soccer net at the middle school one time, trying to get him out of there. He didn't kill himself or anybody else. It's just something different every day. That's probably the best part of my job.
Okay. And are there any negatives to your job?
As everybody knows, right now law enforcement is perceived pretty negatively in the national media, and I think a lot of that is driven that there's a lot of people that really don't know what the job entails, so they automatically assume that every cop out there is bad in some way, when you're only looking at maybe a half a percentage of the
services that we have in Hamlin and surrounding areas. And so it's a very large job. We're having to do it all the way into the foundation of a building, which includes private property, which has never been done before. Normally, we're just responsible for what we own, which is up to the property line. Now we're going to be responsible for the service line on private property. So it's a giant job, but then, no money's come down from that. So now we have to figure out how to do this giant project within the same structure that we have. So it's good problem solving, but it can get stressful.
Some of ours is the same thing. We have fixed budgets, and school districts across the nation are, they get hit hard with the money side of it. And with now with the new energy codes, it's like the two buildings, we just build energy codes and leave. We have a new debt, which is a BEST grant, which is the state dictates on what we do, because they're paying for 2/3 of those two buildings. So that really made it tough on us, because your HVAC side of it is, your energy code now, the new code is very strenuous. It's a bunch of our money was spent on the HVAC side of those two brand new buildings. So that's been a little tough money-wise to make sure our budgets stay the same. So, obviously the high school here, the maintenance budget on it is a little higher than like the Lincoln, obviously, because of the square footage. A little more. But all it takes is one thing. We lose a chiller right outside here, which is your cooling. We lost it 1 year, and that was $120,000. And that takes a hit to the budget. You're taking it from other schools just to make this one work. So that's probably the most stressful part of my job is the budget.
Okay, so money and public perception. All right, does anybody have any questions that they want to ask before I move on? Okay. Okay. So, did you always know what you wanted to do? And if not, how did you start then?
So originally, I was taking every biology class that I could because I had an interest in forestry. I was planning on going to CSU. How many jobs are available and what it actually paid, so I had to rapidly change my direction. I was heavily involved in ROTC here, and right after graduation, I qualified for Warrant Officer Flight School. Made it all the way up to MEPS, and then found out that I had medical issues which prevented me from going in. But at the same time, I'd also been riding with Canyon PD, so that sparked my interest as well.
I had no idea what I was going to do for a very long time. Before I worked at the city, I was a cook. And I really liked that. I liked the kitchen atmosphere. But as starting a family, the hours and stuff like that didn't really agree with having a baby and stuff like that. So I decided to get a job where I worked more 9-to-5. And so I kind of fell into the city and then realized that really interested me. And there was a path there to... I guess happiness as an adult, making enough money and having a good quality of life. And so it just kind of grew into that position.
I wasn't real sure what I wanted to do. I started out working in construction. I've always liked working with my hands and fixing things. So I started out construction, and I worked at a mechanic shop a little while ago. I did work for a construction outfit, a lot of dirt work, stuff like that. And it wasn't long, and I started here. I graduated in 87 and started here in 92, so I've been here a long time.
Okay, thanks. Guys, I really like how this, I don't think anybody on the stage was doing what they thought they were going to do when they were in high school. Medical reasons, families, things come up that make you change your mind, and that's okay too. And that's why with the Pathways, we want you taking the classes for the Pathways, but we also want you seeing about other classes and what you're interested in there as well, okay? But because life changes things sometimes, and things that are important to you now may not be important to you when you have a family. And so, thanks guys, that's awesome. Can you describe one of your typical work days?
So, I'll give a typical work day from when I was in investigations, because that's going to be more exciting than what I actually do today, because right now I sit around at a computer and draft policy and deal with personnel issues, and a $12 million budget. When I was in investigations, that day could start at 2 a.m. with a phone call saying, we've got a homicide, we need you and your guys down at X location. And we would get there, get the scene secured, start our investigation, and once we hit that initial crime scene, we would start expanding out, doing interviews, neighborhood canvases, crime scene processing, evidence tagging. And that day could last anywhere between 24 and 36 hours all in one shot. So you were running around doing a lot in straight with no breaks. If you were lucky to get a meal, you ate when you could. But those were a lot of good, productive, and fun days. So that's, I hope that answers your question. But law enforcement in general is 90% boredom and 10% terror. Because if you guys watched Cops when it was on the air and saw the action and whatnot, that 5 minutes of fun, if you want to call it that, could last another hour and a half to 3 hours putting everything down on paper.
What was the question?
Describe your typical work day.
Typical work day. So, and I'm probably the same thing. Now I'm kind of doing the desk work, so that's really not fun at all sometimes, but and boring. So in operations, we work a 12-hour shift. We do 7 on, 7 off, which is pretty nice. So it was kind of a nice thing because, this other gentleman, there really wasn't 2 days that looked the same. In a water treatment plant, there's just a ton to take care of. So you could be doing mechanical work, like working on motors and pumps, or you could be working in the lab doing water quality analysis or sampling and monitoring, that sort of thing, just kind of gathering data. And then you could be working in Excel spreadsheets, kind of interpreting that data. What's that telling you? Trying to figure out if like one of our water quality processes are working well. Could be making chemical adjustments, that sort of thing. So it was kind of nice because you just kind of chose an issue to deal with and kind of come up with a process to solve that problem.
It's basically the same thing. Paperwork being the worst part of it, I like working with my hands. Part of the job. So my typical day is you start at 6 in the morning. My phone's hooked to me 24/7 in case there's an issue. We have a water leak in one of the buildings or something like that. Sheriff's Department goes out to McKinley. We've got somebody on the roof or something. I get the calls that come out. And let them in so we can check the building. So it's kind of the same thing for 24/7. Something happens and I'm going to get called out for that stuff. Pretty much when I look at work orders for the day, get those assigned out to the guys. My secretary does that too if I'm already out and about. Somebody calls me first thing in the morning, we've got to go out, so I go out and help them as much as I can. And I could go start looking at POs because I do all the ordering for the district. As far as coming into the warehouse, I'm in charge of the warehouse as well. So, teachers, secretaries, stuff like that, they'll put in orders. When it comes to me, I check budget codes, make sure that they're got the right budget codes on, check pricing on stuff. There's a lot of the stuff is through state contract. So I check the state contract to make sure we can't get it cheaper from somewhere else for the same thing. And then I do the PO, send it through the system, and it goes obviously to the warehouse, and day goes, and then when the afternoon gets here, the bus garage and for transportation as well. So then I carry a radio with me at all times, so I can hear what's going on with transportation in case we have an issue with any of the buses. So pretty much my day goes.
Okay. I'm going to ask one more question, then we're going to take a break real quick. So, what's the importance of your work and its relation to society?
Could you say that one more time?
What's the importance of your work in relation to society? How does it help society?
Well, I mean, it's as far as law enforcement goes, legislatures enact laws. You need somebody to enforce those laws, whether it's a criminal law or in some aspects civil, because one of the tasks that sheriff's offices are responsible for throughout the state is civil process. So not only are we dealing with enforcing criminal law, such as homicides, harassment, assault, stuff like that, we are also responsible for keeping detainees who've been arrested for those charges safe, which protects society from them, and sometimes then from themselves, and then you've got the civil law aspect kind of lumped in on top of it.
Yeah, I think ours is just kind of service to community. So providing clean drinking water to communities is, you know, what we do. And so, you know, if we ever get it wrong, then, you know, people can't flush their toilets, they can't eat, drink water, they can't shower, that sort of thing. So, you know, just making sure the community is provided with that product is the most important thing.
We're just kind of the same way. I mean, we're obviously here for you guys. Try to keep the doors open and cooling and the heating and the water, all that stuff, the best we can for you guys to have a comfortable environment while you're here.
So that's a lot of things sometimes we take for granted. We just assume that we're safe. We live in a safe town. We live, we can walk our streets. We take drinking water, we just assume that it's always there. I know I don't often think about, hey, where did my water come from? But if it wasn't there, I really quickly have a problem. And our schools, I mean, that we're in nice buildings, they're well maintained, they're comfortable in them. And so, a lot of times we don't really think about the people that are doing the jobs that make our lives so much easier and better. So, for now, we're going to take a quick break. We're going to do a brain break real quick. You have to stay in your seat. So we're going to go ride a roller coaster. You guys done this? Because it's the best. I love roller coasters. Just got to stay in your seat. So what we're going to do, for those of you who have been on a roller coaster, you always start off going up. So when you're going up, you got to lean back in your seat. Do not get out of your roller coaster car, or else you're going to fall out. Stay in your roller coaster car. Do not bump into the people around you in theirs. So we're going to be going up, down, left, and right. Okay? So when we're doing left and right, do your left and right. And I will do my best to go the right direction, but y'all know your left and right. You go with it. Okay? Do not, otherwise you're going to bump heads with the person next to you. So, but a few things. When you go down the roller coaster, what do you do when you go down? You scream. So, let's practice. Ah! Oh my gosh, you guys are bad. Okay, let's try it again. 1, 2, 3. Ah! Oh, wow. I don't think they've ever actually been on one. Okay, so you gotta get on a roller coaster, gotta buckle up. So reach up, pull your harness down, buckle it up. Okay, we're going up the first hill, and it always is like click, click, clack, clack, clack. Okay, we're going. Back to Pisa. Here we go. You guys are gonna have a real hard time. Come on, Pisa, let's go. All right, we're getting to the top. Okay, you guys. Like, seriously, not been on very many roller coasters, I think. Wow. Yeah, I was trying to think of a way we can do like upside down, but I can't think of one yet. Any ideas for upside down? But how do we do upside down in our seats? Oh, you gotta put your head down. That's a good idea. So upside down? Oh, I like it. I like it. Okay. Even though don't hit your head on the seat in front of you. All right. Okay, one more time. Let's do it. Going up. Clack, 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 clack. Almost to the top. Okay, down. Oh my gosh! I mean, you guys like a rolling. Wow. Get to the left. Left. Right. Left. Right. Up. Sorry for everybody sitting by him. Okay, down. Okay, upside down. Back up. Upside down. Back up. Left. Right. Left. Right. Up. Down. Okay, we're coming to an end. Yeah, it was a very scary ride, wasn't it? Sometimes I. Oh, thank God. That's right. I've been on some of those. So. Okay. All right. We're going to go back to asking some questions. Do you guys have any questions so far as what they do and how they do it?
What are the benefits?
What are the benefits?
Yeah.
So, as far as what?
Health and pay, health insurance.
Oh, okay. Let's talk pay and benefits. I'm loving it. Okay. Pay and benefits. Let's do it.
Currently, right now, detention staff are starting out just under $17 an hour. With benefits, that includes a meager retirement through the county, but we're actually working on getting that changed. But I mean, pay and benefits for law enforcement are going to vary depending on where you're at. I think that Longmont or Loveland is the highest paying agency in the state of Colorado, and they will start out roughly at $76,000 to $78,000 a year. California pays even more. My patrol captain was out there before he came back here, and he was making right around $120,000 a year before overtime. So it just depends on where you're at in geography.
So for our distribution, fellas, no ladies right now, but we start at about 17 an hour. As you work your way through your certifications, I think within 3 years you can be at 20, 21, I think, an hour. And at the treatment plant, we start out about the same 17 an hour, and within 4 years, if you get your A certification, then you're up around 25 an hour. And so with that comes with the normal retirement. The nice thing about the city is they have really good health insurance. So our deductibles run like 500 a person a year, which kind of in this day and age is pretty darn low. So I know that may not affect you guys right now, but it is a really nice benefit to have. And then the city offers other things like tuition reimbursement. So if you do go to school while you're employed with the city, they'll reimburse a portion of your tuition. So you can kind of go that path while you're there, get some help, which is pretty darn nice. Help with student loans. Yeah, those are kind of the main ones.
Well, for me here at the school district, that was part of the reason. Medical, something. We've got good insurance. There's different tiers you can get through the district. So obviously, when the district kicks in so much for your insurance, and right now the district pays the entire amount. So if you want to go to a little better plan, it costs you a little bit. I think right now I on the best plan we can get, it costs me like $93 a month, I believe is what it is right now. Another thing for the district is retirement. We've got para-retirement, which is huge. It's a very good retirement plan. I've been here 30 years now, and I just retired. And with para, you have to take a little while for this month of October. Technically, not supposed to be at work for a month. I don't know why para does that. It's crazy, but whatever. And then I'm going to come back and do a 110, which in a calendar year, what para does it is, so from January 1 to December 31st, you have you can either do 110 days or 140 days. And that's all you can work in a calendar year where the district's on a fiscal year, so June, July. So I'm coming back November 1st, and I'll do 110 to the end of December, which I know is 110 days, but it doesn't matter. Then I'll come back January, and I'll work right until school starts. August for 140 days. But para is a good retirement plan. It definitely is. It's changed a little bit now because I started so long ago. My magic number was 82, I believe. So it's 30 years, my age 52. I think you're 82 is your magic number. And I believe now for coming down to 92, I believe is what that number is now. So obviously, I got started pretty early, so that helped me out now that it's changed. So.
That's kind of a side note of that. You know, money, you have to have money to be able to provide for yourself, your family, and all that stuff. But, you know, there's interesting studies out there about quality of life and happiness. And I read one like a year or two ago, and they said that happiness, as it applies to how much money you make, kind of levels off after you hit about $70,000 a year. That, yeah, you have to be able to provide yourself. Once you get over that mark, you know, it's not like the more money you make, the more happiness that you have. Quality of life really comes from enjoying what you do, being happy with the job that you do, not the amount of money you make. So while it is a very important question, you know, there's a whole other side of just enjoying what you do. And that sometimes is a lot more important than money.
Definitely do what you love and hopefully make money. Okay. What skills are required as far as educational, occupational skills? What skills are required in order to do your job?
Basic math, and that just basically goes to traffic tickets or theft reports to where you're adding up values of items that were stolen. How many of you, do you guys offer a typing class here? Probably not.
Business apps does some. Yeah.
So I took Typewriter, if you guys know what that is. I think my senior year of high school, and out of all the schooling I took in high school, that one honestly benefited me the most. Mm-hmm. Because sitting around typing out reports, if you're not proficient with a keyboard, it's going to take you a while. But overall, law enforcement's looked at as a master of all trades, or a jack of all trades, but a master of none. So it's kind of a hodgepodge as far as what you take in a course would benefit you in a position. So, I mean, there's a lot of specialized training once you get in it. But up to that point, it's math, it's a lot of English, typing, speech and debate to some aspect, because we talk to people all the time, counseling services. So there's a lot of different things that you can take and make your own and put in your own pot. So, I mean, as far as narrowing it down, I can't. There's just too much that goes into it.
Typing. Typing.
Typing.
Yeah, that's a great answer, you know, because things that you sometimes don't realize that are important at the time, as something as simple as typing, how much that can shorten your workday if you're having to do a lot of reports and stuff like that. But for the water department, it's your STEM stuff, so any kind of science, technology, math, engineering, those skills, just any kind of your problem solving skills are huge. You know, we use a lot of chemistry, biology, engineering, a lot. So, but I think with a lot of any other real position, it's just a willingness to learn. It's a willingness to show up and learn the job and have that willingness to not expect it to come to you, but to put the work in to learn whatever it is that you're doing.
To piggyback on there's typing, yeah, that was, I did the exact same thing. Took it for a week and I'm like, when am I ever going to need this? Of course, it's back in 1987. Our computers were this big or this big. Kept doing that because I have my job now is computer typing reports and stuff like that. So that kind of stuff was stuck with now. Like you said, the engineering side of it for us, there's just so many different aspects to keeping the district running. You're always trying to create something, fix something, and you got to think outside the box and all that stuff. Like I said, a budget, and our budgets are tight, so we've got to fix things that, you know, kind of stuff nowadays is getting to be very expensive, so you've got to come up with ways to fix this stuff, that can't just throw the thing away, you've got to try to fix it, so anything you can pick up in the math side of it, you've got to calculate stuff all the time. A lot of motors we replace around here, we may have one, we kept a lot of stuff when we down Washington in the middle school. We kept a lot of stuff that air handlers, we actually took the air handlers off the roof and put them over at the warehouse. And we have the same units on other buildings, so if we lose a motor, we lose a compressor or something like that, we can take them off of that. So just things that you got to calculate. If it's got a third horsepower motor, the RPMs are 1500 and this one's 2800, but it's a half horse, can I change that motor because of the RPM? Going to work the same because we've got this motor instead of buying a new one. So there's math is pretty big on our job.
Yeah, and just to piggyback on what these guys do, when I said law enforcement's kind of a jack of all trades and master of none, I'm dealing right now with a plumbing issue and a water usage issue with inside the jail. Because right now what we're doing is we're replacing all the porcelain fixtures, and when I say that, porcelain toilets and porcelain sinks inside each individual jail cell, and we're upgrading the water valves to allow us to turn off water if necessary. And when we started this project, we had to reach out to guys that specialize in this to say, hey, what can we do to get this done, because our water usage is through the roof. And what do we need to make the facility safe at the same time? And that project right now is running right at about $460,000 in toilets and sinks to get all that stuff in place. So again, a little bit of everything goes back into the same pot for your knowledge to utilize somewhere else.
What about post-secondary education? Is there any requirements for what you do?
So when you talk trade jobs, I don't necessarily think of law enforcement as a trade job. Back when I started in 96, most agencies required a bachelor's degree just to get hired. And what I saw was you'd get a lot of applicants coming in that had that bachelor's degree, but they were also figuring out that since they had that bachelor's degree, they could go work somewhere else and make a lot more money. But law enforcement as a whole, when you start getting higher up in rank, not so much at the sergeant level, but lieutenant, captain, undersheriff, or department head, a lot of places would like you to have a master's degree in something. It doesn't necessarily have to be criminal justice. It could be public administration or something to that effect. So it depends, again, on where you're at. I know that a lot of agencies have dropped that requirement out of the job description because it is hard to get good applicants right now.
There isn't any requirements for the water department right now. There is a ton of water treatment plants that are going that direction of requiring at least an associate's of science to get in the door. But for right now, we'll take somebody with zero knowledge and train them from the ground up. So.
Now, you mentioned certificates. How do they get those?
Certificates work. So you have to have 30 days experience to get your D license, which is the entry level. So basically, you spend your month kind of working at a water treatment plant. Then you go sit for a test. Then in order to get your C, you have to have 2 years experience. Half of that can be substituted for college classes, but at least half of it has to be time at a water treatment plant. B would be 3 years, your A would be 4 years. So it's time on the job and then sitting for that certificate.
And then you take a test for it?
You go.
So for the district in the operations side of it, we don't have anything that you have to have a degree in. So backflow preventers, we used to test our own because I sent one, and again, I was interested in it, so I sent him to a week-long class, and he got a certificate so he could test backflows for us. We got a lot of backflow preventers here. The backflow preventers are the water. We're bringing the water in from the city, and there's a backflow preventer there so that if something happens, the water in this building doesn't back in and end up at your guys' house or whatever in case there's an issue. Those have to be tested every year to make sure they're not failing, that the check valves in and stuff are working properly. So we can send you to a school like that to get that done. And then on the Siemens side, which Siemens, so our whole district, our HVAC system, all your heating and cooling is run through one central computer. So like all your thermostats in your rooms, it's a thermostat, they're always doing is telling you the temperature, there's nothing you can do with it. It up and down, that's all done from a computer. We've got a computer at each school, so if we're there, we can log into it, but from my office or from the HVAC guys' desk, they can log into it there. And so I can send them to a Siemens class, and we just had, actually, I lost both HVAC guys this past summer. And so the two new guys, I've been sending them to Siemens classes. They just learned this is a very complex system. So there's a lot to learn on that side of it. And they get certificates when they're all done with these classes, and there's five different classes, all the way up to programming, where there's, because there's 99 lines of programming per point. So all your air handlers have multiple points in them. Tell the fan when you come on, tell the damper to open and close, filters, they're getting dirty. Tell the belt's about ready to break because your amper all goes up or down on the motor. And all those have points. Each one of those has 99 points to it. So there's a lot for them to learn. So that schooling has been really good for them. And as you get up in administration, I've always been one in my job now. They really didn't have a job description for mine because it was multiple things and two people that do it. They just kind of lumped them all with one. And it did one a bachelor's, which is good. No doubt I get. But I look at it from my side. I don't know about you guys, but I look at it experience. That's huge for me. Show me what you can do. Don't tell me what you can do on a piece of paper.
Okay. Are there other industries that you would be called? Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I just have a question for him. What kind of person do you work
What kind of what?
Prison.
What kind of person do you work on?
A kind of prison do you work at if you do?
I don't work at a prison per se. I work in charge of the county jail. So that houses anybody sentenced to county jail up to a maximum of 2 years or pretrial detainees. So the an actual prison is somebody that's been convicted of a felony and they have time to serve that is over a 2 year minimum.
Okay, because that is a good distinction. A lot of times people confuse jail and prison, but there is a difference. Brad, did you have a question? What was the most challenging part when COVID happened for their jobs? Okay, that's a great question.
Wow.
All of it.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, all of it. You take every aspect of it and then dabble in on the political side of things, too. Our number one concern with the jail was keeping COVID outside of the facility, because we were seeing other agencies like El Paso County had 700 positive inmates at one time. And besides holding people, we also have to move them from facility to facility under a writ. So we would have our transport units go up to El Paso County or even out at the ADX at FBOP and move inmates. So they were getting that exposure. It was getting the staff to wear their masks. We had to change up our entire intake procedure to where we would not accept an arrestee into the facility for a low-level crime. Victims' rights offenses, to where you actually had a victim, we were mandated to take those. So we had to put steps in place on the jail side to mitigate the possibility of COVID making it into the facility, and then once it did, we had to contain it to one area of the facility. November last year, we had 56 positive inmates in one pod. 20 days later, that number dropped to zero, and we kept it out. Right now, at this current time, I have 10 positives, and they're at the end of that 14-day period. With patrol, it was getting the guys to wear masks, and then deal with people for calls of service out on the street who weren't wearing masks or were freaking out when our guys weren't wearing masks. And then, of course, we were dealing with the phone calls from people outside the area wanting to know if we were going to make physical arrests for people that weren't wearing masks. Our position now is what our position was then. Mask mandates are not criminal law. It's not a law enforcement issue. It is a mandate put down by a public health department or a state public health, and it is up to them to enforce. So I hope that kind of answered your question, but we had to jumble a lot of stuff around. And still keep the procedures in place to where if COVID came up again, we could immediately go back into that operating principle.
For us, it was a big, so there's a acronym called COOP. It's short for Continuity of Operations. So for us, we're a 24-hour plant that has to be managed by an operator. We only have a certain amount of these operators, because like we spoke about before, it takes 4 years for us to get to an A certification, which means you can run the water treatment plant by yourself. So it's not like we can just bring somebody in off the streets and have them run the water treatment plant. So it's trying to keep our operators healthy in the beginning when, you know, there was a whole lot of firestorm about it. There were water treatment plants that their operators were just living there. They pulled their RV up to the water treatment plant and there was nobody in or out, and they had groceries delivered to them, and, you know, that's the way that they handled it. We did not do that. What we did is we sent our relief operators home for a month at a time and said, you're not, you know, this doesn't mean you're on vacation. Stuff is because we need separation from some operators to the other. So if we do get sick and it starts spreading, then we can send those people home, clean the facility, and bring other operators home or in. So with those relief operators going home, you know, then we had a staff of four to do the job where normally we had Now it seems to be a little bit better, just because the quarantines aren't quite so long. We had quarantine for 2 weeks just because you came close to a contact with a contact or have a crew went, that creates staffing issues really, really quickly. And so I think now that that's in a better place, it's good to serve that stuff.
For us, it wasn't quite as bad. I mean, obviously just masked up and things being gone here at the schools. I mean, actually kind of just a chance to catch up on a bunch of stuff. Those guys had to stay separated a little bit because when we got out in here, we still had to mow the grass and fix sprinklers and stuff like that. I mean, stuff still had to keep going on. So really, it didn't hurt us too bad on that side of it. It's the aftermath that we're seeing. That's, to me, that's worse than the COVID thing. We can't get parts. The lead times are just ridiculous on everything right now. I mean, there's stuff that needs fixed right now that we're not going to get parts. I think that's the biggest factor for us is the aftermath.
Yeah, I'll agree with that. So we're going through a project right now. We're upgrading our electrical systems for some of our raw water pump stations. And not only not being able to find the parts, I mean, lead times being months out, but the prices for that stuff are skyrocketing. So again, having a fixed budget, now you're having to do a whole lot more for our less. So yeah, it makes it tough. And with kind of the government budget rules, at least we fall under, is if the money that we have for 2021, it all has to be spent in 2021. That means that things have to be delivered in 2021. It means the work has to be completed in 2021. You can't start a project and then have it end in 2022 and use 2021 money. So everything has to be done in a time frame. You can't really push it off. So that creates time crunches.
Yeah, and that for the sheriff's office, we ordered 5 brand new patrol vehicles in July of last year, and we still have yet to get delivery on them. And we just actually found out the end of last week that Dodge canceled that order because they don't have the chips to go in the computers that will go in the trucks. What we've seen this year so far is gas prices go up. So what used to be, So what, fuel used to be $1.48 a gallon, now it's up to right around $4, and just for us to operate the patrol division and take calls for service, our fuel budget is getting chewed up to the tune of roughly $9,000 to $10,000 a month. So it's costly right now.
To give you an idea on how much it's affecting, we've been told for next year that the base inflation for a lot of what we do, chemicals, mechanical parts, that sort of thing, is expected to go up 15% out the door. And that's if everything goes really well. Generally our budgets go up about 3 or 4% per year, just naturally going up due to inflation. So, 15% versus only a 3% raise in the money we're taking in kind of gives you an idea that makes the budget look up really quick.
So there's
going to
be a lot of fancy work with the money and trying to find new ways to get around things.
Yeah, well, like you said, the transportation side of it, I ordered 3 brand new buses. We do them on a lease purchase every 3 years, and we rotate our buses. This is a year for 3 brand new buses, and we usually have them by the start of school, and they're saying maybe December. They've been going for over a year, and you're right with the fuel costs right now. That was something we were able to save a little bit during the COVID piece of it because we weren't doing trips. I mean, the trips right now that we're going out are just crazy. I mean, you guys know, everybody goes on trips and fuel costs, even with us, they tax on it, but still, fuel is crazy price right now. So that takes a real hit on the budget.
Yeah. What is one positive thing you do at work?
I think it's helping people in general. Whether that's somebody that calls in on 911 that needs our help, or a staff member that needs my help because they have a positive COVID family member in their house and they need extra time off to
only time people notice a dirty house is, you know, when it's dirty, or house is when it's dirty. So the only time people notice water is when they have an issue with it. So nobody's calling us, and we're doing our job with us. Yeah. Okay, we're good.
Same for the school district. Same for me, just keeping the doors open. That's big for us, not having to shut school down.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? How many days a week do you work?
So right now for patrol and detentions, they're on a 12-hour shift. So they'll work 3 days on, 4 days off, or 4 days on, 3 days off on a rotating. Investigations are set up to where they're working 4-10s. Administration, we try to work Monday through Friday, but there's other times we'll end up working Monday through Monday. It just depends on what we're dealing with. But for the guys working the shift and actually doing the job, they enjoy the 12-hour shifts because they get extra time off.
Yeah, kind of the same. For all of our support staff, it's generally Monday through Friday, 7 to 3:30. For our operators, it's 12-hour shifts, 7 on, 7 off. So kind of working those 12s for a week, and then you get a week off, so they really like that.
It's pretty much the same. Administrators, I mean, you're 7 days a week, pretty much. And then for the guys, it's Monday through Friday. Summer times, when you guys aren't here, it's 4-10s. They work. They really like that, so.
Any other questions? What would you do differently if you could start over?
I don't know if I would do anything differently. I've always kicked around the idea of being an outboard engine mechanic, but that's just because I like to work on my own outboard. But I mean, there's plenty of other jobs looking back on that I was interested in or might make more money now, but I think the path that I chose, I'm happy with it, and it's been a good career choice for me.
Yeah, kind of the same. I mean, there are times where I wish I would have went to school, went to college before I started the career, but, you know, like you said, starting at the bottom, there's a lot of benefits to that in learning the job from the ground up rather than kind of coming in top level. But in saying that, having your schooling sure does make things easier sometimes when you're kind of going through a career path. So it's kind of pluses and minuses one way or the other. I will say that I'm going to college right now because when you're kind of going to management, at some point you just have to have a degree to go forward. You come up against the ceiling. You got to have that check mark on the resume to go further. So that's what I'm doing right now. Would have been a lot easier to go to school when I was in my low 20s than in my late 30s now with a one-year-old and a new position and that stuff. So it's, you know, if you're going to go to school, I would say that coming out of high school is a great time to do that rather than later in life. You've got a lot more responsibilities.
Yeah, and just to piggyback on that real quick, I'm currently in college right now finishing up my bachelor's. 25 years ago, as soon as I got done with my associates, I just wanted to get out and work. If there's one thing I could do differently, that would be it. Because managing an entire agency while going to school on the back end chews up so much time. And college back then was a lot cheaper too. So if you're going to go into something like that where you need a degree, knock it out first before you think about going back to.
Yeah, I mean, they're right. If you're going to go in the corporate world, for sure, you're going to have that degree. You're just going to try to jump right into that instead of starting at the bottom and working up. There's no doubt you're going to get that degree. But there's somebody out there that's just not your path, and that's fine too. I mean, it's, you know, I just lucked out. Our last superintendent, he said, you need a degree. He said, you've been here a long time, and you know what you're doing, and trust what I was going to do, so
you know, that's where it kind of goes into, you know, you don't have to necessarily go to school direct or college directly out of high school, you know, kind of try to figure out what you would do want to do rather than just going to school kind of flippantly, if that makes sense. Like, just spend some time trying to figure it out, and whether that means traveling around and trying different things. I mean, the high school nowadays, I think, does a really good job of being able to intern, so get a taste of what you think you might like, you may not want at all. And just try to experience as many things as you can to figure out what you do like, and then go to school for it.
And I've seen a handful of people over the years that they'll start in law enforcement, and then, and I'm not kidding, 15 minutes later after that first call for service they handle, they're turning in their badge and their ID, or that can extend out 6 months. So you do have a very valid point on that. When I was in school, besides forestry, I was also thinking about teaching, and I took Future Teachers of America here and was assigned to a sixth grade class at Washington School, and I found out within about a week I didn't want to be a teacher. I mean, that's what you're looking at. And I've noticed over the years job descriptions have changed to where they say you have to have a bachelor's of science in criminal justice or accounting or whatever. Now they just say bachelor's or master's. They don't tell you what that has to be in. They just want that four-year college degree.
That's a great point. Generalized degree instead of a really specialized thing. I mean, if you know that's what you want, fantastic. But you know, getting more general degrees like a bachelor of science or something like that, it just checks that box. You know, you can use it for a lot more.
Yeah, they're right. I mean, you get that, check that box. I mean, that's a big thing. My son's a prime example. He went, got his bachelor's, and he really didn't know what he was going to do, and now he's a fireman. So he just had that, so he was actually out of the fire department, doing a bachelor's. The weird thing is, a lot of places, they don't care what it's in. There was, like for my position, it was, they wanted a bachelor's.
Showing you how the fortitude to go through with it, and that, you know, getting a bachelor's degree is a hard thing to do no matter what you're getting in. And you can't just go in and get it done in a year. You have to have again, the fortitude to go through 4 years of impressively harder thing, and you saw it to completion. And it's kind of showing that you had that work ethic to do that. And that's kind of what that's proving. And there is a lot of knowledge that comes with that.
What time does this class end?
It ends about now.
Sam, what you got?
What's the hardest thing about working the same job?
Me, it's different every day. It's different every day. You gotta find a different one. It's never boring here.
Yes.
That's pretty wonderful.
My class, I'll take your papers. Go through. Go through Hamilton's class and get your stuff.